you have to be in the connected through your teacher or mentor, coach, your peers, to those experiences where people been to those places and they've overcome those.
All right. Welcome. Welcome back, Roman. Welcome back to the Simcast. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing really well, and I'm so happy to be back. Thank you, John.
Fantastic. So excited to do this next episode with you. I really appreciate you coming back. We've had a couple of good opportunities to do interviews, and so really looking forward to touching on the topics of trading mastery with you today.
That's fantastic. Let's do it.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah. Why don't we just jump right in? And, you know, it's such a deep subject. I'm wondering if we can define it. Like, I'm wondering if you can define it. Like, tell me, what's the definition of trading mastery? Like, what is it? What does that entail?
I think that it's not anything specific to trading. It's just specific to mastery just in general, because anybody in any profession with any even activity or sport activity, you know, when you are going to the level of mastery, you're going to go through the specific steps, and you will have to do it almost in the same way in any profession, where you will have, you're going to come as a beginner. You will not know what to do or how to do this exactly. You will just know like approximately of how to do this, because maybe you've seen other people doing it. And trading is very elusive, you know, in terms of like, you know, creating the mastery with your trading path, because trading is very simple. It's basically two buttons, buy and sell, right? So anybody could trade. Anybody could put the money in and then say, I'm going to buy this, or I'm going to sell this. So from that perspective, it's a little bit elusive in terms of the mastery because of the simplicity of the first initial step. Other professions, like, you know, like if you want to be a surgeon, you can't really do that right away, or otherwise you're going to kill your patient. So, but the path to mastery in my mind is always the same. You have to understand what to do, what you're doing, then to practice this, then to understand in which kind of like sequence you're going to do things, and then to have the appropriate mental landscape to support all of your activities, and then repeat year after year. And then you become very knowledgeable, very skillful. You develop, you know, your process of how you do things, and your mind actually is accepting the whole reality of who your identity now.
So is it then, is mastery a, is it an end in itself? Is it a place that you arrive at, or is it the path and then ongoing path to get there?
Well, I mean,
you said it's elusive. So are we always striving for it, or is it a place where like, okay, I've arrived?
I mean, in a very conventional way, it's definitely, you know, a path that is going to be unfolding, and you're always going to be on that path of mastery. So for instance, I've been doing this for 25 years, you know, trading markets, education, and I feel that I'm still kind of like learning so much as to how to do things. And I'm still developing a lot of skills. I'm still developing my mental landscape and so on and so forth. Having said this, there are certain milestones that we should acknowledge as we go through, you know, acquiring the knowledge, acquiring the skills. And we should kind of, you know, like pat ourselves on the shoulder and just say like, yeah, good job. That, you know, you've reached the next milestones.
What would you say are some of the milestones that you've reached in your career? Like, how long did it take you to hit those milestones?
Well, I think the first one is when you have to acquire the knowledge, or when you have to define what method is the most appropriate to you, when you kind of have to understand who you are as a trader, what time frame you're going to trade, what volatility you're going to trade, you know, what, you know, systems you're going to trade, that could be relatively fast. Although sometimes I see a lot of students kind of like, you know, go back and forth, you know, from one idea, from one belief to another. That discovery phase could take a couple of years, sometimes more, depending on the person. In my case, it was kind of almost instantaneous, but I did have about maybe like from 2 to maybe like 3 years, maybe 5 years, where I've been studying different methods. I've been taking CMT exam. I've been, you know, studying Wyckoff a lot. And then at some point I just realized, you know, like Wyckoff method is what I love. And, you know, that's the only path for me. And I want to specialize in this. And I want to become such a specialist in this field, you know, that I would develop a very, very, you know, high skill.
You know, what's interesting about what you did not just say is anything about profits. Like, well, your first milestone was like picking the educational path that you think is going to lead you to that. I think that's really interesting, because I think most traders, once they get started, they want to judge themselves or gauge their path by, I guess, their P&L, their equity curve.
It's still, I'm not against of creating financial milestones. If anything, you should have those. You should definitely say, and for the first, let's say, 5 years, I would say your main milestone for the year should be a profitability. You should not be concerned about, you know, making specific X amount, but just being profitable. And I'm talking about the beginners. So if somebody who's an advanced trader is listening to this, that wouldn't make sense to you at this point of time. An advanced trader should define, you know, what are your profitability targets, what are your consistency targets, what are your, let's say, volatility of the portfolio, equity targets, and so on and so forth. But for the beginner, being profitable at the end of this journey is very crucial. Then the second step is going to be, could you be profitable and could you be consistent? The next step is going to be, could you be profitable, consistent, and could you be profitable at the specific level? And then could you be profitable at the specific level with the specific kind of like volatility to the portfolio? So there are, you know, different several steps to that. But as a beginner, you only have to concern yourself with consuming the information that will lead you ultimately to the correct methodology, correct behaviors in the marketplace, and then that will lead you to profitability and consistency.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, so it's something that you need to maybe add to your goals, I guess, is obviously you want to be profitable, but keep your expectations realistic in that what you really need to be focusing on, just like the surgeon you mentioned earlier, like, what residency, you know, what med school do I want to go to? What residency do I want to go to? What specialty? Yes. I mean, all those things along the way. Now they're probably making a little bit of money once they get into residency and so to speak, but they're paying that intuition or that tuition to begin with. And then looking for that profitability to really start compounding once they've invested in their education. Would you say that's a...
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just take an example of, you know, a surgeon and the doctors. And I mean, right here, I don't think that they get a good salary until like year, what, 8, 9, 10? They are studying and they are practicing. And then they go to hospitals and they are being told the procedures as to how they need to go about things. And then obviously the, you know, the mental preparation for all of the operations, you know, surgeries and all of that stuff, it's on the background and they're going through that as well for, you know, 7, 8 years. In trading, people don't approach trading like this. It's a kind of like an instantaneous need to be profitable. And that's what, you know, detracts a lot of people from trading investments. And then they, you know, I hear, you know, people come to me and they're like, yeah, I tried it. it didn't work out for me. I think it's gambling. So what they did is they tried it. It was too hard. Maybe there was some kind of realization that while it's so hard, then I need to find the reason, unconscious reason of to get out of this. But I need to get out with decency. So I'm going to blame it on somebody else. And I'm going to say, like, it's gambling, you know, and that's it. So I've met, especially at the beginning of the career, you know, I've met quite a lot of people like that who tried, you know, some of them were my friends and so on and so forth. And they've created this kind of like negative connotation in their minds about trading and investments in general. But and especially with investments, you, in our modern world, when people, you know, go to work from 9 to 5, they come home, they have families, and the incomes that we have from 9 to 5 jobs is not enough right now, you know, to sustain our lifestyle that we want. So you have to be invested in real estate. You have to be invested in the stock market. You have to be diversified through different investments. So you need to know something, or you need to give the money to a professional who is, you know, has had this experience, and just allow them to create some wealth for you throughout, you know, multiple decades of your life. You know, going away from the market is probably not the smartest idea, I would say. I think the smartest idea, you know, if you don't want to get involved with the markets, is just to give the money to professionals and for them to manage it.
Yeah, fair enough. So it basically, I mean, if you're not invested in it, you're losing money. I mean, even if you're just holding cash and saving, I mean,
mm-hmm.
look at inflation.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Point well taken. Can you have anything less than reaching mastery in order to really succeed in the market? So if you're not going the route where you hand off your money to somebody who knows what they're doing, and you're going to manage it yourself, and you want to be a trader, you want to do this, like, is there anything shy of mastery that will allow you to make an income in this?
Yeah. I'm right at that place. I cannot say that I am, you know, a full master of, let's say, even teaching or trading. It's ongoing. It's developing. I mean, I'm at a certain milestone. I might be ahead of certain people. I'm definitely behind of certain people. So, but you can still make money. You're making money with your own personal accounts. I'm making money, you know, with the hedge fund and so on and so forth. But could it be better? For sure. Could it be improved? For sure. Could I make more money? Yes. Could I be more consistent? Yes. So I can't really say like, oh, okay, I'm a master of this. You know, it's going to be unfolding until probably I die.
Got it. Yeah. Well, you know, thinking back, like on the milestones that you've had,
mm-hmm.
was there anything that you would do differently? Like, and is there anything that, because I'd like to kind of segue eventually into how you teach this mm-hmm. path to mastery to your students at Wyckoff Analytics. But is there anything that you would do differently that you're maybe trying to implement now with your teaching? And is there anything to speed up that process of becoming a market surgeon, so to speak?
Yeah, a really good name, market surgeon. I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely would force myself to practice even more. I was lucky enough to kind of stumble upon the post-analysis really early on in my career. So I remember like in 2000, at the end of 2000, when we had the rally off the bottom after the first initial decline. And I've told you about that point. I had a drawdown there. And I sat down and I said, okay, let me just kind of see what I've done wrong. And let me go through each trade that I've had. And from there, there were certain conclusions, such as like, oh, okay, I didn't have a trading plan. So I didn't really have as well-defined rules within the methodology as to what to do. So I wish you know, in a way, I would kind of continue with that and practice more and transition that knowledge from the post-analysis into my simulations, where you basically, you know, have your setups and you just like practice. I am an NBA fan. I was, you know, the season just started as we're recording this session this week. So I'm kind of like immersing myself a little bit into the new season, the basketball knowledge and so on and so forth. Well, I mean, I have several. I started watching basketball when Jordan was still playing Magic Johnson. So awesome. That was like, the Magic Boy was not already at the same level, but Jordan was like, you know, like a star.
I remember those days.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then obviously, you know, Chicago Bulls was my first team, then Lakers. And I was drawn a lot to greatness and, you know, and kind of like mental approach to the game. So I really liked all of the teams by Phil Jackson. And, you know, anybody who came out of that system, I absolutely loved, you know, Greg Popovich, you know, and his style of coaching and the way how so many people came out of that program and just populate NBA right now in the coaching staff and so on and so forth. So it's kind of similar to me to what we do in how we approach, you know, the education and how we educate people. But just to come back to the thought of, I was listening to some of the, you know, watching some of the programs, how they're preparing for the season. They spend a lot of time practicing. Why is that? Like, when you take somebody like Steph Curry, and obviously I'm here in Bay Area, so Warriors is my team right now, for sure. I've been a Warriors fan for like, you know, over a decade now. If not more, but why would the best shooter in the history of the game still come to the practice and practice for hours at three point attempts, you know, like three point shots? Why would he do this? That just doesn't make sense, right? But it does, because it's a skill that you have to repeat in order for you to be mindless and to be in that state of, you know, almost like unconscious mastery of it. When he gets on the court and he just like shoots and it just goes in, and it's all the hours and, you know, of practice that he's done. Why is it not being applied to trading and investments? Why do people think that they don't need to practice? And in my mind, when people come and I suggest to them, like, you got to simulate a lot and not forward, but on the historical charts. So meaning, and trading sim is like, why am I attracted to you guys? Is because you have that platform. You know, you have the capacity for students, for traders to simulate so many different environments, so many different setups and so on and so forth, with so many different assets. It's extremely useful. And I wish I would have done it more early on in my career.
Wow. Yeah. You know, and I think that's the point that a lot of beginning traders seem to miss, is that how important that simulation is, because they don't realize that they're going up against Steph Curry when they're in the market. You know, there are so many sharks out there that have been doing this for, you know, even longer than you have.
Of course.
And how, or I guess why do beginners think that they can just enter the ring with, you know, all these experts like, you know, Steph Curry and, you know, there's so many sharks in the tank when it comes to trading that, and you were saying that, it's not that there's so much out to get the retailers, but.
Yes. I mean, like, it's a competition with yourself. It's not, you're not competing against anyone else, you know, like institutional traders are not after you. You know, if you think this way, you really have to rethink this. It's, you know, it more comes from failure that goes into like egoic state that tries to protect yourself. So you come up with certain reasons of why this has happened. And obviously ego always protects itself and, you know, tries to come up and put responsibility on someone else. Okay, oh, this is institutional traders. No, it's you who put the incorrect stop loss. It's you who entered the position incorrectly. It's you who closed position prematurely. It's you who did not put the stop loss in, and so on and so forth. So, you know, we're kind of touching upon also, you know, the mindset here a little bit. And this is something that comes a little bit later. You know, trading is a great metaphor for me personally and for a lot of my colleagues that, you know, have been doing this for a while, over personal development. So as any craft, if you're going to go to a very, very high level of mastery in any profession, you will go through the same steps. And then at the step where you're extremely skillful, you will recognize that everything is working well, but it's you who has some mental, emotional limitations as to, you know, how much you could expand your business or how skillful you could become or how much you could allow yourself to experience in terms of the, you know, ups and downs. At, you know, at that point, you are at a very advanced level, but you're still working on your craft, but now you are realizing that, you know, you as a tool of that specific methodology, you have to improve as well. So trading is a path to a personal development. And if your goal is to be at the very, very high level, you will have to raise the level of your self-consciousness as well. And this is a big topic for me personally, because I'm kind of residing there right now, and I'm like learning a lot of stuff, and I'm practicing a lot of stuff, and I'm doing a lot of stuff with the consciousness and so on and so forth. Ultimately, every trader would have to go and confront self and raise that consciousness.
Well, that's interesting, you know, and it seems like now that, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's kind of like step four of your foundational educational components that you teach within the Wyckoff analysis, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not necessarily teaching it within the framework of Wyckoff method. Wyckoff method is just the knowledge and skill building.
Right.
We add to that
at wyckoffanalytics.com.
Yes, I guess. At Wyckoff Analytics. Yeah. So methodology only provides, you know, a set of beliefs about the market, what the market is supposed to do. So Wyckoff method says there is a set of institutional investors, analysts that are composite operators, that are smart money. They have more information, they are more skillful, they have much bigger size of their equity accounts. And so they're influencing the markets. And therefore, we are studying the ways on how on the chart to identify their presence and then follow them. The way how we do this is that we first study those sets of beliefs that we see on the chart, and then we practice them. So those are the first two steps. So these are methodology steps. Then some methods would allow you also to kind of go into the process. The way how you trade this, you know, knowledge is one thing, recognition of the pattern, you know, as a skill is another step. But then the third step is, well, how do I actually trade this? So for instance, on the weekly basis, you might be going through a specific routine where you go through the specific stocks, you select specific stocks, then you put them on the watch list, then you trade off that watch list, then you follow that those positions, and then once the positions are closed, after your trade management throughout the whole time that the position was on, you start post analyzing, you know, those trades, you extract the information from there, and then you reinsert it in your process. So that's step number three. That process step, again, is not necessarily a part of a method, of any method or a method, right? And then step number four is just when everything is established, you still see certain mistakes. And then you start realizing that it's actually me who is kind of sabotaging the whole trade. And then you start looking at yourself, and you have to be extremely honest. I mean, all of the high level traders that I've met are extremely self-honest men and women. They have to see the reality of the market, and they have to see the reality of self. Otherwise, if they don't see one of those, then the trade is going to go down, is going to, you know, go down, and you're going to lose money.
Well, let's if we've got time here, let's try to kind of pick apart each one of these. And I'm thinking about something that, like, a conversation that you and I have had in a prior interview about kind of like the educational cycle, mm-hmm. like what's missing in education in the trading industry. And in combining that with the question earlier about, like, what's, you know, what would you have done differently, or what do you wish you had had, maybe, for traders nowadays, like how can we, or I guess, what do you offer, like, mm-hmm. in the way of knowledge, and then skill, and then process, and then mindset? If those are your four core educational components, let's talk a little bit about maybe knowledge. Like, how are you building that? How are you starting them off?
Sure. Yeah. You start with the basics. You have to understand how the market works. That's number one. Secondly, you start, trying out different methodologies, and you look at the specific market beliefs. Like, for instance, a belief about the market could be that the market is an environment of uncertainty. So you have to know this belief, you have to accept it, you kind of have to experiment with this in trading, where, you know, you get into the position, as in the previous recording I showed you guys, like, and it does go against you, you know, significantly. So that's uncertainty. And this is the environment where you operate in. So you collect those beliefs. And then you study by reading a lot of books, reading a lot of articles, listening to a lot of people that have that knowledge. Going on YouTube and educating yourself, signing up for specific courses. And this is the extremely active period of where the beginner is acquiring the knowledge that is necessary. And it's not that all of the knowledge will be used, but it's being done because you need to define, you know, your style of trading. You need to understand what the market is about. So for several years, you might be in this period. Now, you might be lucky, and you might end up in the place where the knowledge is great, and this fits your personality right away. So I was lucky that way. I kind of almost instantly, within the first, second year, I got into the Wyckoff method. But it took me maybe like 3 years to realize that, yes, I just want to specialize in that, because I've been studying Elliott, I've been studying other things, again, I've mentioned CMT exam, and beginners are going to study a lot. At the intermediate level, once you already define that this is my methodology, you have to start specializing in your readings around that subject. So anything on that subject, you read a lot, and anything around this subject. So maybe some areas of knowledge that are, connected to your methodology. So you want to read on that as well. And you want to create some kind of understanding of how all of those kind of like sub additional layers of knowledge you could incorporate into your knowledge. At this level, you also start practicing. The beginners are not necessarily going to practice a lot, but you know, the intermediate traders, they will start practicing. And this is where you start developing your skill. Then when you go to the advanced level, my advice to our students is just to stop reading altogether. Like at that point, you're probably like into year 8, 9, 10. And at that point, you've read a lot. You've read a lot on technical analysis. You've read a lot on your subject. You've read a lot on subtopics and subsubjects that are around your kind of like, you know, circle of knowledge. And it becomes a distraction. You're basically not extracting as much knowledge per a unit of your reading. Like, let's say you pick up a book and then you get like one or two or three ideas that are new to you, which is great, which is still marginally an improvement, but it's not the same as a beginner. At the beginner starts reading the book, there are so many ideas that are new. Like, you know, 80% of the book could be like completely like, wow, this is aha after aha moment. Advanced traders should not waste time on reading additional material. What they should be reading is charts, and they should be practicing a lot. Mm-hmm. So they should theorize less and they should practice more. And
now, are they back testing their own strategies? Are they, in other words, are they creating their own material to study by?
Yeah, in a way, this is a really good way of describing it. They're creating their own material, right? From observations and deductions through looking through the charts, whether it's backtesting, whether it's simulation. I mean, backtesting and simulation are very close to each other in some ways, because both kind of like create that mental level of confidence in the system and the ability of the trader, you know, to execute the system. But at the advanced level, just, you know, like my advice is not to waste time. And the way how I read books right now is, first of all, I ask people to read books for me. I mean, that might sound a little bit strange, but I just don't have a lot of time. So whenever somebody asks me like, oh, could you read this book? I just basically say, I don't have enough time for this. You have to give me the synopsis or the main idea that attracts you to that particular book. And that way I will learn much faster and more effectively. So
one of your students doing that in WTC2 or something like that. He took Wyckoff and basically condensed it down into PDFs with visuals, which was amazing.
At that level, you just concentrate on execution.
That's cool. So if I'm hearing you correctly, then knowledge, skill, process, mindset, it may not be so much as like, oh, well, you're a beginner when you're in knowledge, you're an intermediate when you're in skill, you're advanced when you're in process. It's more like they're still kind of on, all four are on, always ongoing. It's just
ongoing. Yeah.
The more you advance, maybe the less you're going to pull from, you know, books and things like that and the knowledge component of what you're teaching, and the more you're actually going to pull from, you know, process and back testing and mindset and all those kind of things. Is that?
Yeah, absolutely. So those, you know, if you're thinking about in terms of the pie and like, you know, 100%, so like, you know, the beginner is going to spend 80% of the time just reading and going to courses, studying, doing homeworks, you know, things of this nature. You know, more intermediate level trader will incorporate skill building, which is going to be, you know, first backtesting, then, you know, some kind of simulations. And, you know, that ratio is going to change. And then advanced trader is most definitely going to only specialize in that particular methodology and going to specialize in execution, feedback, process, you know, and so on and so forth.
Now, Wyckoff Analytics, you have something that basically addresses these at each level, you know, whether it's fundamental technical analysis course, WTC 1, 2, practicum. What maybe can you kind of step us through the curriculum that you've created?
Yeah, sure. So we have a basic course, which is even kind of like the course that you could get before you enroll into the first major step, which is WTC 1, Wyckoff Trillion course. In Wyckoff Trillion course, part one is all about analysis. So we teach people how to make observations and how to make deductions on what you see on the chart. And that's kind of like the first step. It's all around the knowledge. So we are given a lot of information about how the market works and how do we want to operate in the marketplace and how, based on what kind of like chart reading techniques, we could, you know, construct those operations. Then the second level, the practicum, is where we still give knowledge, but this is more specialized knowledge on the specific subjects. And also it's more advanced knowledge. Because at that point, you know, the level of knowledge is sufficient, you know, to discuss more advanced concepts. And then at the same time, we are practicing in each class. And we're practicing a lot with the homework, and we have other means of practicing. So our students, for instance, do a lot of post-analysis at that level. Our students do a lot of simulations at that level. And that's a combination of kind of like cementing the knowledge from the first level and also starting to practice it. And then when you go to the third level, then you start thinking about the process. And so we have specials on how the process needs to be created. And then we have also, we call this the Wyckoff Trading Process Group. So this is where advanced traders establish their process. And then on the weekly basis, they see what kind of adjustments they need to make. So there is this constant feedback, whether this is private sessions or whether this is a group session, or whether this is like, you know, emails, feedback. And at that level, you start going into their mindset as well. So you have specific, you know, sessions where somebody put on kind of like a hot seat, and then, you know, you go through realizations of what's going on incorrectly in my trading. And then, you know, as a group and then individually, like as a coach, you give the feedback and, you know, the student corrects, the trader corrects the behavior. So that's at that level. And then the last level is just kind of like all about you. So there is a lot of individual work. So it's kind of more mentoring at that level rather than teaching, because traders at that level already know exactly who they are, what they want. They know exactly what mistakes, blind spots they have, and they just intentionally work just on that. And that's kind of like the whole educational circle that we have there.
How important is community to mastery?
Well, we always say that trading is, you know, a very lonely profession, right? Because you sit in front of the screen, you have like so many charts and so on and so forth. So you get discouraged really quickly from your mistakes. And the tendency of the ego is to go to darker places, to have that self-talk where it might end up in a place, I'm not good enough. And it's very hard to overcome on your own. But when you are surrounded in this specific ecosystem, when you're surrounded by peers, when you have access to somebody who has been to those places, like for instance, myself, a teacher, I've been to those places. I've been to the places where I would be down on myself after a drawdown. I would be down on myself after a losing trade. You have to be connected through your teacher or mentor, coach, your peers, to those experiences where people been to those places and they've overcome those, because it gives you hope that you can do the same. So therefore, the ecosystem, you know, and especially peers, are extremely important. What is not important is sitting on the chart, on the chat, and just like typing away for the whole day as to like, oh, let's look at gold. Let's look like, you know, like at the markets. Let's look at cryptos and so on and so forth. This is such a colossal waste of energy and time and space. So I never encourage doing that. What I am encouraging our students to do is to get in groups or get together, you know, get with your coach, get with your mentor, look at the trades that you've done, identify what was done incorrectly, identify the areas of whether you need additional knowledge, you need additional skill building, you need adjustments in your process, and then, you know, go and doing this. That is effective. Sitting in the chat room and, you know, looking at the screen for 8 hours and then still withdrawing yourself from the actual work is just wasteful.
It's not so much the need for a community, but the quality of the community that you're getting. And
absolutely. So you want to surround yourself with traders, people, students, mentors, coaches, and especially coaches and mentors that themselves want to improve each day, because they are strive for improvement, success, will transition, you know, to the things that you do in the market. So you want to find the community that most definitely has that type of, you know, undeniable strive for excellence. But I understand that it's hard to find, but it's easy to find because you kind of could see right away, you know, what people are doing, how they're thinking, what their beliefs about the market, what's their routine about the market. You know, you could literally quickly define, you know, who's who in the marketplace.
Wow. Sound advice. Yeah. I mean, and it's so easy as a beginner to kind of get wrapped up in the noise and the excitement and, you know, the chat room and the alert and the news and, you know, all this kind of just flashy stuff. So I really appreciate you sharing that. It's good stuff. Well, why don't we, you know, I actually kind of thought of it might be nice to come back with you at some point, if you're willing, and talk about how to review. I think that could almost be a topic in and of itself.
How to review what?
Just how to constructively review, whether it's journaling, backtesting,
yeah,
that sort of stuff. But maybe we can save it for another time.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Lots to talk about. The reason why I can talk about those things is twofolded. Is because I went through all of them and I'm still going through them. And then I'm in the unique position to see others who are doing the same thing and who are going through the same kind of like, you know, obstacles. I'm just, as we talk, I'm kind of like realizing that I don't think that I would change anything in this model. It's a very effective educational model, you know, for us traders, where you acquire knowledge, you acquire skill, you build the process, then you work on yourself. So my advice to anybody who is serious about trading, who's listening to this recording, consider it. You don't necessarily have to come to us, but consider the ways of how we educate and educate yourself in the same way. Position yourself for success in a much shorter period of time, then rather than just going and stumbling upon something and then, you know, withdrawing and, you know, taking a lot of time, a lot of years, you know, to go through all of this. Technologies are here, you know, there are people that have shown to you many, many times that you could be profitable and you could be consistent in the marketplace, but it's going to take effort and it's going to take time, and you will have to face a lot of, you know, kind of like dark places in yourself. And if you're willing to do all of this work, you know, on yourself, and what a wonderful concept of just like working and adding value to yourself. Like, isn't it great? You want to improve as a person, and trading is that vehicle to improve as a person. It's wonderful. You don't have to do anything else. Consider all of that. And hopefully that's going to push you to do and develop yourself, to go out and develop yourself in a more proper way.
Perfect. No, that's perfect. Well, let's, why don't we end it on that note, Roman? And if you're, you know, viewers, please check out WyckoffAnalytics.com. Follow Roman at Wyckoff Analysis on Twitter. Is there anything else we need to throw out there?
I think we've done really well. So John, thank you so much. And TradingCM.com, thank you so much for having me. Hopefully, you know, this is not too much. And I'm looking forward to hearing from you guys, you know, listeners, any type of feedback, you know, shoot me an email, find us on the internet, and I'll be really happy to connect.
Perfect. Thanks again, Roman. Be sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more great content. We'll talk to you later.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks so much for watching. If you enjoy our content, please subscribe to our channel and be sure to like our videos. Also, check out TradingSim.com/blog for more content.